Hi, this is Kay. Thank you for checking out today's podcast of Hanging with the Hayters. We want to give special thanks to our sponsor, Sunny Horn, with Leaders Financial Group. You can give them a call at 832-381-2515. And welcome to Hanging with the Hayters, brought to you every Wednesday at noon by Leaders Financial Group and our financial guru, Sunny Horn.
Sunny Horn, woohoo! Yeah, that was my shout out for Sunny Horn, Kay. By the way, ladies and gentlemen, today, very special show. One of my, my best friend, long-term friend, Johnny Sutton, is with us again. He was with us last week. Johnny, you were with us.
He was an observer.
He was an observer, Kay. What do you call it when you observe a class, but there's a word for it. I didn't take the class. I
audited
the class. I don't know why. Yeah. But Johnny's actually mic'd up.
I didn't take any notes last week, though.
That was true, but he didn't need to. Anyway, I tell you, after the show last week, Johnny, you know, he drug his buns over to our house, and we sat there and talked for a good while, and this guy has so many stories. I mean, he worked for Work Davis Estates. He'll talk about that a while. He's a forester. He got a degree in forestry, same time I did, and only he used his degree. And anyway, he was telling about stories about backwoods people and all, and I thought it was, or people he met in the backwoods, fascinating. So I made him show up today.
You were very persuasive.
I was so persuasive, and he kept, no, I don't think so. And I made him. So anyway, Johnny Sutton, we'll introduce him more today, but right now, okay, we just need to mention stuff first before that, and what has to do with this Saturday. And you know, this Saturday is something that crept up on me a couple of months ago. Don Hampton said, Mark, I need you to help out, be one of several MCs at the Rising Stars Legends of Texas. It's some kind of art thing, and I mentioned it last week, and Dick had to actually explain most of it to me, what's going on. But that time is coming, Johnny.
It's this Saturday.
It is this Saturday, and from noon to probably it'll be after 7 o'clock, probably 7:30. Be emceeing several shows. One involves the actors group out of Montgomery. Their drama department is put on a play, or they're going to put on a play that is a most depressing play, which means they must have super actors, because it's one of those things I just would not care to be in.
And I think the Conroe Art League will have the art gallery open. Yeah. And anyway, there'll be lots going on, including vendors with food, folks. And
vendors,
I think that may be, you know, the big draw.
Johnny, I don't know what you're doing Saturday, but you would be well served. You might find a big piece of art you might want to buy or something.
I don't know what I'm doing Saturday either, Mark. But retired guy.
Boy, that's right.
They might have roasted corn. We don't know.
Ooh, corn on a stick, Kay.
That's what Mark likes.
Anyway, that's what's coming on. And anyway, that's, please, ladies and gentlemen, I think a lot of things open at noon. I'll be at the Crichton Theater with Dick Schischler, our president owner of Lone Star. And anyway, he's going to be there airing live some radio play broadcast, one by youngsters and one by the Owens Players Thinger
Theater Group.
And we've got a call right now, Kay. Can you believe that? We're right off the bat.
You want to make a bet on who it is?
No, I don't, but this is fascinating stuff. I'm so proud. Caller, you're calling Hanging with Hayters. Kay's here, and I'm Mark, and Johnny Sutton's here. Who are you, and what would you like to tell us about?
Mr. Mark, this Lee Wong.
Lee Wong. I would take
wife to Conroe Regional Medical Center to have baby, and she have baby, and they bring me the baby, and it be a white baby, and I say to nurse, no, two Wongs cannot make a white.
Okay.
She say to me, I think that your baby, what you gonna name that baby? And I say, Something Wong. That true story.
I believe that. Sounds like it.
I believe that. Lee.
You can't make this stuff up.
He can't. And by the way, you still in the restaurant business?
Oh, yeah. Very, 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 very much. And restaurant and pest control.
Oh my gosh. Okay. Lee, that's very interesting. And I,
well, congratulations on on your new baby. You didn't say if it was a girl or a boy.
Well, I hope it was from the name. I don't know. In fact, I've already forgot the name.
But it is a girl or a boy. I'm not sure.
What
a
okay. Okay. Lee, thank you so
ask
much.
Ask your wife, Mr. Wong.
You know, our listeners need stuff like that to know what's going on in this town, and we encourage stuff like that. Lee, thank you so much. I appreciate it.
And, bye-bye now.
Bye-bye.
That could have been the Wong number.
That could have been the Wong number. Okay, Johnny. Anyway, so that was Lee Wong, and I was expecting.
We hear from him from time to time.
We do. This guy, he's got a million.
I didn't know that.
By the way, speaking of that, Kay, at the end of this show, we are going to have a joke. You know, we used to have a joke, and then a story. Well, we're going to have a story near the end of this show, but we're also going to have a joke because I read one today that I thought was pretty good, and I'll share that with you. Anyway, that's going on, and I do this every week because it's so good. I plug Johnny, the Courier's telling Montgomery County story for 125 years.
And their history section.
Yeah, that's how long the Conroe Courier's been around, and here they've got the front page of Friday, April 20th. That would be today, but the year is 1934. So many things going on, and I did not know this. Kay, I bet you didn't. Conroe had a baseball team then. I don't know if they were semi-pro or what.
I did not know that.
They were called the Conroe Oilers, and they won. So this is the April, 20th edition. So that week, they beat Tomball, and Tomball was called the Wild Cats. I wanted to say Wild Eats because this is blurred print. But they beat Tomball 7-4, and, man, it made the front page of that. Also, officers combed Gulf area for noted killers, and the killers were Bonnie and Clyde.
Wow.
They were known. There was word that while they're in the area, there was a place around here that they frequented. I think they had kinfolk there. That was one thing.
Were they killed in North Texas? Somewhere up there?
East or north? Actually, there are several. Their car is in several places.
it was in pieces when they got through.
Maybe they spread the pieces.
One's in Louisiana, and it's some town. Obviously, it's in some town, but there's claim for several of them. Anyway, just like the baby Jesus, there are several places where he was born, I think, over there. I can't remember them all. Anyway, other things went on. I know Sam Cable, and here on April 19th, 1917, they're showing some of the stories back then. April 19th, 1917, Louis Cable and Maurice Alley went to Houston to enlist in the Navy. This was 1917, ladies and gentlemen, April.
World War One.
And the Navy, you know, World War One, the Navy, the American Navy was just not much back then. The British Navy was really big, but I can't imagine joining the Navy. They were sent to the Great Lakes in Illinois. Okay, that makes sense. And it was reported about 50 of their friends gathered at the train station to see them. Another thing, April 1935, the record attendance at Conroe ISD was 443.
Wow.
In all Conroe schools was 443. However, in 1925, it was 35. It was 3,976. Fascinating
stories.
Well,
it was growing even then, and it's still growing.
And I didn't want to end it there. I wanted to also, I opened this up, and there is this story about Everett Brothers Hardware, Everett's True Value Hardware.
Yeah, we talked about them before.
Yeah, I mentioned in 1908 that they, I didn't mention 1908 because I didn't know it, but they had a grocery store, and it burnt down in 1911 with the town of Conroe, most of Conroe.
Oh, they had a fire down here. It was on the square, wasn't it?
And they rebuilt it. In fact, it was right down there to the right. I don't know if they, you know that place we had breakfast a while back?
Mm-hmm.
I think it's in
that would be on the east side of the Courthouse Square.
Yeah, but the store was somewhere in that vicinity. They got a picture of it in this thing. Anyway, nice stuff. And, of course, in 1958, and I say of course, I don't know why, that's when they exclusively went to a hardware store. And anyway, it was, like I mentioned last week, it was the greatest hardware store. Things cost a little more because it's mom and pop, but son of a gun, were they nice? Were they helpful?
They knew their stuff.
Oh, man, no kidding. They knew.
And you didn't have to go looking for somebody to help you either.
You know, I don't know how they, I'm assuming the people they hired to be their clerks and all must have been family because they knew everything.
Very
knowledgeable. I mean, I know what this thing does, and how can you afford to pay someone that knowledgeable in a salary, at least not anymore? Anyway, record was broken when $1.8 million in lots were sold on the new golf course at Walden. This was 1976. Ladies and gentlemen, Walden has grown big time then. But this is, anyway, the Courier. By the way, there were three letters to the editor that people were real upset. And the reason was they had some news that was just not right. I mean, it's one of those fake news things, but they believed in it, and they hammered some other politicians based on what they had heard elsewhere. Mm-hmm. But I won't mention.
Say, kid, you know, we have our little outline that we use every week.
We do, Kate.
And I noticed next on the outline it says, how does anyone kill land lines? And I thought it said land mines.
Yeah, CK, that is different. And by the way, we have got a nephew named CK, or is it CJ? It's CJ. Never mind. CJ, I'm sorry.
Distant nephew.
nephew. Anyway, we do. And, Kate, what this was about, I don't know about you people, and I don't know about Johnny with respect to telephones, but there is no way on God's green earth that I could be comfortable with a cell phone for my main phone. My cell phone has... It's tough for me to hear, and it's just, I don't enjoy holding a flat object when I'm talking.
It won't hold a charge.
Right. Mine does not hold a charge. And I have to have a landline. It's just, and these people just pick up the phone. One thing, Kay, that ticks the willies out of me is most people's phone, and raise your hand if this works with you, but no, don't raise your hand now. I'm trying to explain it first. If you hit your button to turn on your phone, how long does it take to turn on?
A while.
Mine's a while. And if I'm trying to call somebody, I got to be sitting there. And here's what happens, Kay. It comes on, and then all of a sudden, it goes back off. And then I have to turn it on again. The second turn, okay, now I'm ready if you're serious about it. And I call. So
So the message here is don't call Mark on his cell phone because you're not going to get him.
Please don't. It will ring, and by the time I find my phone, it's gone, and nobody leaves messages. Yeah. And so.
Message here is you're getting old, Mark.
That's another thing, Johnny.
Yeah.
And,
well, we live kind of, I don't know, it's funny because sometimes our cell phones work inside the house and sometimes they don't, and I never know.
Yeah, metal roof. I don't know what it
is.
Weather.
Anyway.
Weather.
Could be. Also, nighttime. I don't know what it is, Johnny. But I wanted to say something because, Kay, one thing about our show, and Johnny, you'll learn, is I like to inform people. I like people to be a little wiser, smarter, you know, when they leave. And son of a gun, I saw this research on smiles. When you're smiling. And somebody actually did research. And folks, there were several of them that mentioned this. Only one said a number, the number of smiles there are. And you could make up more, there's no question. But they all said there's several smiles. But very few of them indicate that the person is happy. We have so many weird smiles, and you can tell, you can see them in some people. I mean, the happy smiles are, wow, I got money.
And then there's the smile you give when you're looking at somebody and you really want to kill them.
Exactly. And there is a smile for that.
Well, when does it go to a smirk?
The smirk is very close. The smirk's the closest thing, and, well, I hate to say that, but we saw it yesterday on the news when the one of the officials from South Korea was talking with, taking a photograph with our Secretary of State, and he had...
Wasn't it our Vice President?
It exactly was our Vice President.
That's different.
Okay, it's completely different, because our Secretary of State never smiles. But anyway, and this gentleman was shaking hands, and what I read is people, Japanese, Chinese, and this is stereotyping them, or it's categorizing them. But
you're going to get letters.
Their culture is not to express emotion in public. You don't. You know, your dog died. And you go cry at home or whatever. And they don't smile in public. But if they are, congratulating someone, the smile is this. It is a flat, their lips become flat across, and their eyes squint to where you can just barely see them. And I say that if you need to watch, you need to watch these things, particularly in you know, you see government officials shaking hands. This guy, I just read that, and I sat down to watch TV, and this guy was shaking hands with Pence, and he looked at the camera, and I said, son of a gun, flat across, you know, somewhat of a smile, but it's not. And his eyes, he just squinted where I couldn't see him. Anyway, stereotype.
I thought he had a nice smile.
So
but...
if you're, right now, if you are of Asian ancestry, if you'll go to the mirror and give us a your normal smile, and that'll help
us. Okay.
By the way, I've got other things to mention.
We're moving on at this point, right?
And exactly. Okay. By the way, there's a smile you give when someone's talking to you and you want to realize, hey, I'm awake, I may not be listening to you, and that's one particular smile, and it has nothing to do with joy. Mm-hmm. One thing that does have to do with joy for some people out there is we've got to take a break, Johnny. We're going to take a break. We're going to come back. I'm going to finish this smile thing. We're going to talk to Johnny about our friendship and what's going to ruin it. Back, ladies and gentlemen, in a couple of minutes, hanging with the haters.
Hello, I'm Sonny Horn with Leaders Financial Group. For 25 years, Leaders has developed a working relationship with each of our clients that aid us in providing them opportunities to retire sooner than they likely thought possible. Our success is attributed largely to our thoroughness in drawing up a workable financial plan for each client. Saving money is tough for most, so we all need to receive the best long-term results possible for our efforts. Leaders Financial Group has earned a reputation for providing greater peace of mind for those who too often feel they're hoping against hope in what seems to be a most complicated financial market. Our goal at Leaders is to provide a keen sense of hope and financial security for those who come to us seeking direction. Process is simple. Phone call even more so. I'm Sonny Horn. Give me a call at 832-381-2515 and we'll help you establish a financial future that'll be ready when you're ready to retire.
And I'm Mark Hayter. One of the clients at Sonny Horn has helped retire sooner than I thought possible. It's our trust in him that led Kay and I to choose Leaders Financial Group as our sponsor.
Listeners, this is Mark with Hanging with the Hayters, and of course my friend Johnny Sutton's here, and Kay also. And I've got to stop Johnny saying, of course. It's overused because normally, of course, is, you already know this, why am I telling you? But you didn't, you know, people don't know, of course, that didn't make sense. But when we left, of course, I was talking about smiles, and Kay, I did so much research on this, I hate to just kill it here. Let me tell you more things about smiles.
Okay.
The history, or some countries. Like I said, there are 19 smiles, or I don't know if I gave you a number, but there's 19, only six of them are associated with joy of any kind. But in the 17th century in Europe, this is way back when, and when I say 17th century, that's the 1600s.
Right.
That's confusing to people, Johnny. I don't.
It always confuses me.
It kills you. Yeah. They said that the rich people considered any person who smiled, where you could actually see their teeth, they were poor people, that the rich were above that big of a smile. They would, and so you were rich. That was an indication that, wow, I just told something very funny and I couldn't see that guy's teeth, so
snooty,
he must be
snooty,
rich.
Snooty.
Mm-hmm.
Norway. And Kay, remember Tim Huffman from church was telling us he lived in Norway.
He lived in Sweden.
They're the same.
They're next door
to one
another. They're
Scandinavians.
Yeah, they're good.
They believe, they have a saying over there. It's a joke that's pretty true. They say, smiling strangers, if you see a smiling stranger, in other words, he's not a Norwegian or whatever, he is either drunk, he's insane, or he's an American. In other words, you pass one on the street and they're smiling.
Yeah.
Okay, you're drunk. I don't have anything to do with you.
Yeah. I remember Tim, when he was in Sweden, he was there to do missionary work. Mm-hmm. And anyway, he said if he would ask anybody anything about, you know, are you a Christian or anything like that? They were very suspicious. Like, what do you want to know? Yep. What do you, you know, what do you want?
Yeah.
So, anyway, they should have known he's an American. He's nosy.
Yeah, and he's nosy and smiling. In Russia, smiling with no reason, they say the culture was that you're insane. You're not, you know, they see a person smiling, he's nuts. In other words, I'm thinking, what do you have to smile about over there? You know,
well, life is tough.
It's tough, and then you die.
You're
Japan.
Right.
I mentioned Japan. they stifle their emotions in public and normally. And it's one thing about, you know, when I guess Americans go overseas, and I haven't ever gone overseas. I've gone down to Mexico. And
we've been to Canada and Mexico.
But for the most part, you know, you see people that are not nearly as open as we are. And somebody mentioned to us just the other day, like in Texas, if, you know, you drop a grocery bag or something, somebody's going to run to you and somebody's going to say something or, you know, hello, how are you doing?
Help you pick things up.
Yeah. And if you buy something and, you know, don't say anything, that's kind of frightening. But in other countries, that's pretty much the norm, I would guess. And once again, stereotype, ladies and gentlemen. I don't know what they do in Australia. Papua New Guinea, I really don't know. They may have some special handshake. One thing I do know is that Johnny Sutton is here, ladies and gentlemen. Johnny is a gentleman that,
You went too far there.
Went too far, gentlemen. I'm sorry. I already.
Already.
Yeah, I've exaggerated his. No, that's not true at all, Johnny. See, you can tell he's humble. But we have known each other since the second grade, and Johnny, for the life of me, I do not know if I knew you from school or did we move. We must have moved to Pinewood Lane, and you lived across, you lived down from us, one house between us. And I remember meeting Johnny Sutton and his brother Craig. One thing in Dorinda, I never knew much about your sister Dorinda other than she was really cute. How much younger is she than you?
Oh, Dorinda was 6-7 years. So okay. There was an age gap there.
Yeah, there must have been. But I remember Craig, and one thing I want to say about Craig, we're not going to leave him altogether, but we used to call him in college Egg. Where did that come from?
I was always assigning nicknames, which I like to shorten the name, and it just, I guess I was tired of saying the whole word Craig, and it went to Egg.
Egg.
I don't know. Don't really know.
Don't like it. Do you realize, remember what you called me?
Well, later in college I did.
Yeah.
I don't think you ever liked it, but.
I didn't understand it, but.
That was part of the reason I liked to use it, that you did not like it, but. Jocko.
Yeah, and you got that from?
I enjoyed saying Jocko. I thought Jocko came out of your mouth.
I remember that.
Smoothly, and
yeah.
I just like saying the word, so we were around each other, and I decided I'd change it to Jocko so I could use Jocko.
The story I heard at first when you mentioned it was your uncle. It wasn't your uncle, but it was someone's dog, your grandpa's dog named Jocko, and you see me and said I acted like Jocko.
I
blew that up.
You blew that. Okay. You came from somewhere.
Yeah, I'm so
sure. Well, there's worse things to be named after.
I guess so. By the way, Johnny and, we were in the second grade together, and on YouTube, whenever this comes out on YouTube and on our website, I'm going to put a picture of Johnny in my second grade class picture, and we're standing together. In fact, I wrote an article last week. It's going to be in the Villager today about some of the stuff with Johnny and I growing up, and we were in the second grade together, and Johnny's memories of the second grade are limited, I would say. I remember stuff, and Johnny thinks I'm making it up, but I don't. I mentioned I was in two plays at Ritchie, and in the second grade, Johnny was in the same grade, in the same class I was, and everyone in that class had to be in a play, at one particular play, because the teacher, you know, if you left somebody out of the play, you're in bad shape.
Yeah, but, Harris going to get mad at you.
Well, I just wasn't play material. They found that
I
out early.
That.
And I was blackballed.
You were
play material.
I was play material, Johnny. But I can tell you this, that picture, class picture, you look like a renegade.
A second grade renegade?
Yeah. Anyway.
How tough can that be?
Gee, kid, it only got worse from there. Yeah.
We went to high school together. We didn't make it in junior high. In fact, we were on opposing football schools and opposing football teams. You went to Jackson.
Yeah.
And Jackson was feared in the district. I went to San Jacinto Junior High. And y'all were considered on the other side of the tracks in Mean. And y'all pretty much were.
I wouldn't deny that. The crowd I went to school there was pretty rough and mean.
Right. You remember Gary Clark? I can mention Gary
Clark.
Gary was wild and crazy, and he became a Pasadena police officer, and several people did. Went to high school, played football. Johnny was great at, he was all over the field at one time. I kept mentioning the South Houston High School game, but what was officially your position in defense?
Rover back. Yeah, but in the eighth grade, Rover, the coach had given me leeway to play anywhere I wanted. I could line up deep. I could go anywhere I wanted to. I was truly a Rover, so I played what they call Rover back.
That's and I say that, I bring that out. I know y'all are very concerned about it, but it's because Johnny was a great tackler. I don't mean form. I just mean if there was a guy with the ball running anywhere near him, he was going down. He might be tripped. He might be grabbed around the back of his pants or something, but Johnny was really good. Then we went to
college. I appreciate that because I remember a lot of guys that ran over me and ran by me and everything else. That's what I remember.
I'm so sure. I didn't see all of those, but, boy, I remember several games.
Back to the neighborhood, when the Hayters moved in, I'm going to just say that the Hayters didn't fit into our neighborhood. We knew right off they were different. Mark had an older brother, Dennis.
Yeah.
But when we went down to their house, we found them to be well-behaved, and they didn't try to beat the pulp out of us. That's mainly what the new kids in the neighborhood did was we ended up in a fight. So the Hayters were really a blessing to the neighborhood, and good guys, and we got along great.
That is so.
Yeah, their mom ran a tight ship,
She did.
Well, they listened to their mom. That's right.
You know.
And their mama, they had to be. She kept tabs on y'all.
She did. The only fight I ever got in there was helping Dennis fight one of the Smith boys. Just a picker. And you had trouble with him, too, if I recall.
Harry.
Every neighborhood's got at least one set of bullies.
So. Well, there were four Smith brothers, I told Mark. One of them was a terror. Two of them was out of hand, and all four of the Smith brothers were a considerable mob, I'll say that.
Several stories we will get to, but right now, Johnny's going to have a story for us in just a little bit when we get back from this, our third and our final break segment. Back in a couple of minutes. Hang with the Hayters. Hey, Johnny Sutton.
Hello, I'm Sonny Horn with Leaders Financial Group. For 25 years, Leaders has developed a working relationship with each of our clients that aid us in providing them opportunities to retire sooner than they likely thought possible. Our success is attributed largely to our thoroughness in drawing up a workable financial plan for each client. Saving money is tough for most, so we all need to receive the best long-term results possible for our efforts. Leaders Financial Group has earned a reputation for providing greater peace of mind for those who too often feel they're hoping against hope in what seems to be a most complicated financial market. Our goal at Leaders is to provide a keen sense of hope and financial security for those who come to us seeking direction. Process is simple. Phone call even more so. I'm Sonny Horn. Give me a call at 832-381-2515 and we'll help you establish a financial future that'll be ready when you're ready to retire.
And I'm Mark Hayter. One of the clients at Sonny Horn has helped retire sooner than I thought possible. It's our trust in him that led Kay and I to choose Leaders Financial Group as our sponsor.
Did you know Mark has a humor column in Sunday's Conroe Courier and Wednesday's Woodlands Villager? He's been a columnist for over 30 years, and I think you'll enjoy his skewed perspective on life's ups and downs. And thank you for hanging with the Hayters this afternoon. We've been sitting here visiting with our good friend Johnny Sutton. I met him in college, but Mark and Johnny have been good buddies since second grade. And we were talking about Johnny being working as a forester and land manager for the Wirt Davis Estates over in Liberty County, back in them deep piney woods. And Johnny has been telling us some stories that'll make your hair stand on end sometimes.
Johnny, before we let you loose with that, Wirt Davis, I mean, she mentioned Liberty. It's Polk County also. More land in Polk than Liberty?
Or? About evenly split.
And how much land did the family have?
We managed, for the family, 60,000.
How did you get the job, might I ask?
Well, Marilyn, my wife had graduated. And we were both unemployed looking for a job, and I saw that on the bulletin board at Stephen F., the man who hired me and was the forester there, Charles Franklin, had put a little bulletin board taking interviews for the job. I interviewed with Mr. Franklin, and he hired me. It was the first job I had out of college, and it's the only job I ever had till I retired.
Isn't that some few people?
Quite unique in America.
Yes, it is.
I would say
sure
so.
I considered it a blessing.
Yeah, really. Goodness. I didn't know. I mean, I knew you'd worked with the consultant forester for a while and all, but that was the big job. And y'all managed a bunch of acreage, and I'd been talking to Johnny, and son of a gun. You know, Johnny, you were saying about, you know, you can tell people in 60,000 acres, and you know, in my mind, you have 60,000 acres. Holy camoli, that's a lot of land.
You made a comparison to Lake Livingston, and would you explain that? Because I don't know that I ever understood totally.
Well, it was Lake Conroe. The stories that I've revealed to Mark in the past, we had a big block of land that was all one track. It sat there by itself. It was 20,000 acres. And the people who've been out on Lake Conroe, that is the same size as Lake Conroe.
Son of a gun.
Surface.
So the
60,000 would be three Lake Conroes in the area.
That's right.
All right. Well, that's helpful.
Johnny, you've got so many stories and all, because you've dealt, and with me, it's I was with the Forest Service. I didn't see that many wacko people, but I mean, I was one of them. But you've had some very unusual times. Is there one that stands out you could just share with us at this moment?
People would ask me what I did all through life, and when I would get into forestry and start telling them what I did in forestry for a living, and they would either fall asleep or be yawning in about 3 or 4 minutes. And I found out real quick that people didn't relate to the business of forestry real well. So it kind of keep people from falling asleep in a way. I went to the more outstanding stories, the stuff that didn't really fall into the forestry end, but was part of our job is taking care of the family's land. And it involved characters and conflict and plots and what, but
you know,
it's not a short story, Mark. This is a 50-year period where this all unraveled.
Well, I mentioned backwoods people in the article I wrote about you, Johnny. I said I was a particular character, and it was one of the men, the guy you're talking about, 50 years worth of stories about this guy.
Yes, but, you know, I told you your character reference was way underrated. He exceeded character by a long...
You've seen characters before.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of characters. He far exceeded character. He had his own realm.
Give us examples of what your example.
It's hard to put it all in at all. But the end. One story is a doctor story. It's pretty quick. He came up out of Liberty County, came to Livingston one day to a doctor that we all knew well, had a family general practice there.
What's his name, the man?
His name is A.J., A.J. Davis.
You don't remember the name of the doctor, do you?
Yeah, Dr. Newman.
Son of gun.
Okay. Yeah, his daddy retired with the Highway Patrol for the state of Texas.
Son of a gun.
But anyway, the old man came into his office, and he had a bad infection. Something was lodged in his back. It had gone inside and become infected. And A.J. would have probably handled that on his own, but he couldn't reach on his back and take care of it.
Yeah.
But it'd become infected pretty badly. The doctor informed me that he could take care of that. He would have to clean up that wound, but that he would have to give him a general anesthesia shot there, and then he would proceed. Well, AJ told him that he didn't have any insurance. He was paying for all this, and he didn't have any money for anesthesia. And the doctor said, "Listen, sir, I'm going to tell you." He said, "I'm going to start the procedure, but at some point," he said, "you will ask for the anesthesia. It's going to happen.
You're going to pay for some anesthesia.
You will ask for the anesthesia."
Right.
That's right. Well, AJ said, "No, sir, you just go ahead and start on with your business." Well, the doctor did, fully thinking that he would call for it. Well, AJ went through the whole procedure. He never flinched, never made a move. And he fixed him up and paid the doctor, and the doctor went into his nurses there and his staff, and he said, "I've been doing this a long time." He said, "I have never seen anything like that in my life."
He said, that is one tough old man.
Yeah.
And he kind of summed up AJ, a lot of things he did in his life weren't going to turn out well for him, maybe involve pain, bad things. But when AJ had set his mind to something, it was done. He was going to live with that.
Yeah.
That experience with the doctor always came back to me that it was a great insight.
Right. You know, you mentioned, I mentioned he's backwoods. Why did Work Davis have business with him at all?
AJ had bought some old deeds, and AJ was claiming land that really belonged to the family. He probably in his own mind convinced himself that he owned it. He did not. They were court cases through the years. The courts turned AJ down and told him that his title was not any good. But,
So he was living on property that didn't belong to him?
Yes, he came on, and he never would stop. He was going to come on to the Work Davis property, trespass, and build little shacks and whatnot that he did, and fences. And we were working for the family. We had to oppose that. We couldn't let him build up a legal stance of any sort. So
how long?
Over 50 years, this unraveled as a constant antagonistic. I hate to use the word battle, but it was a
struggle. So if y'all had just let him live there, eventually he would have been able to gotten title.
Yes, under the limitation laws of Texas, if you can occupy land, put a fence on it, an enclosure that is totally enclosed, pay taxes to the proper authorities, the state says that you do own that property at that point. So
y'all had to from time to time.
We had from time to time. Enter onto the property and oppose him and show and prove that, say to him in effect that this property belongs to the people I work for and you cannot, what you're doing here will not be allowed without being opposed.
Now,
it's all legal. Lawyers could get involved on it and tell you that, but we had to oppose him from time to time.
Okay, now imposing, if he's not there, you tear his fence down and all, don't you?
Yes, we would tear his fences down and disrupt things. He never had much over there, but his structures were all around, and we kept up with that. But this didn't happen every other week, you know.
Yeah,
we
right.
let time pass. We would realize we had 7 years, so sometimes if AJ was on fairly good behavior, he was over there and stayed out of the way. 5 or 6 years would rock on, but he was. He had spent some time in a mental institution in Rust. State of Texas had sent him there. And
so he didn't have a job. He was just living off the land, basically, right?
Yes. Okay. It's now these shows now, there's What the Survivor Man and Naked and Afraid. Let me tell you, AJ was doing all that.
Yeah.
Long before anybody had any idea about
it. He could have his own reality TV show today.
I tell you, AJ, you know, they send him, one of those shows, they send him out for 21 days. You could send AJ in there in the same spot with the same equipment these people have. And if there was something there that walked, crawled, swam, or flew, some kind of critters, AJ was going to kill it and eat it.
Yeah.
And these people would always come out, they tickle me, they come out with, oh, lost 15 pounds, lost 30 pounds.
Yeah.
I promise you, AJ would have put on 5 pounds in 21 days.
Well, you know, and the other thing, Naked and Afraid, you mentioned, from the stories you told me, he was never afraid.
Mark, you're right. That exactly. Now, I'll say this. He was never naked. AJ wore no clothes, and in the winter, he had enough clothes to stay warm in the winter. He wasn't naked, but he was never afraid.
You mentioned...
He dealt in fear.
Yeah.
He liked to make people
AJ
afraid.
Used fear, and AJ used fear quite a bit all through his life. To help himself out, he knew about fear, but he didn't really experience fear.
Well, I can just imagine you having to go in there and, you know, oppose him. That would have been the scariest thing. And Johnny, you walked in the dadgum woods most of the time. It sounds like by yourself.
I reconned and did some stuff, you know, alone. I did.
that didn't want to carry people with me most of the time. But when we went into, we just call it a mission to seek and destroy, when we were going in to disrupt his stuff,
yeah.
I did carry one employee with me. And we were armed, and we had fully discussed the action we would take if we encountered AJ. And basically, it was to retreat, fall away, and not encounter AJ. That was, and most of the times we were, in fact, we were successful at that every time. I took kind of a little pride in that we never encountered AJ because he was in there and he was lurking. We had spies, though. We had spies over at the sheriff's office. I say spies. They were friend of a friend who knew a friend.
Yeah.
And with calls, we could find out when he was confined and AJ was locked behind bars. And we managed to do most of our
seek and surveil. He got picked up on a regular basis for some sort of
misbehavior? Oh, yes. He was locked away for short periods of time all through his life. And when we found out where he was, although that was no guarantee, if AJ was released at 5:30 that one evening, I guarantee you before the sun came up the next morning, he would be up the river, take his little boat across on the west side on the Davis property. And we could have encountered him. So there were no complete guarantees with AJ. So we always thought we were very lucky that we never encountered him face to face. Although I encountered him once by myself, Mark, face to face. That ended all right. No problems with that encounter.
Well, we'll get into that another time. But, I mean, he didn't have a car or anything, did he? Or how did he?
No, he hitchhiked almost his whole life up and
down
Highway 146. He did have a car for a short time. He convinced the government in one of the floods in 1980 that he had a brick veneer home on a slab that was washed away totally by the flood. And I know for a fact that he was given disaster relief of $12,000.
Goodness.
And his brick veneer home was no more than a chicken coop. In fact, most of the people in Liberty County provided a better place to live for their chickens than what AJ had.
Oh, my gosh.
He did have a car. I get off the subject. But he did have a car a short time after he got the $12,000 settlement for about 8 or 9 months, and then that car disappeared.
You know, I got to worry about time, but Johnny, I can't let this pass. You painted a picture of AJ, but there is a story that he once wore a tuxedo, and it's very fascinating. It reminds me of Andy Griffith and Ernest T. Bass, but this guy was one tough Ernest T. Bass. Do you mind telling that story?
Well, when he entered on to the Davis property, he came from the east side of the river, and there was a subdivision in there with a lot of homes, people who lived there. But AJ would come in on the east side and then cross the river over to trespass on the west. But he befriended some of the people, and he had gotten pretty sweet on one of the women that was quite a few years younger than AJ at the time. But he went and rented a tuxedo, a full-dressed-out tuxedo for, I guess, a week, because he wore it for several days. Talked and encountered to a lot of people who thought that was a strange sight in Liberty County, and asked AJ about his tuxedo. And he informed that he was going to go ask for this middle-aged woman's hand in marriage in his tuxedo. And we heard the story that he did. He approached her and asked for her hand in marriage. And she, in the best way she could, declined AJ. Kind of sad part of the story was the woman was really quite fearful and talked to her neighbors for some time after that she would probably have to sell her house and move.
Yeah.
She was.
That he wouldn't take no very well.
AJ yet. Did not. AJ had a way of settling grudges and arguments that didn't go well for a lot of people.
Yeah.
But to my knowledge, she never sold the house, and also no harm or anything ever happened to the lady. But we call that the tuxedo week that AJ had in his tuxedo.
Yeah. She should have advised people on how to deal with AJ. She was the only one that.
Well, you know, it went peaceably, and she must have been quite the diplomat, because in that case it all worked out.
Yeah. You know, Johnny, in time will tell us about his encounter with AJ, and it just shows you that, you know, he may be nice at one moment, but then just like that. Something, my dad was bipolar or something. I don't know what. He was nowhere near an AJ, but we could be all happy as could be, and then something would happen to Dad, that something, maybe a word or something was said that would set him off, and you just didn't know where you stood. And that's the thing about if AJ wanted to get you, you know, the sheriff department isn't going to be able to help you. That was just, anyway, there's so many of that, and Johnny's got so many other stories and all, and I like stories. We were talking, Johnny, previously about how, you know, times have changed so much, and I'm not saying this time is worse than any other time, it better in so many ways, but, you know, people don't tell stories anymore, it doesn't seem like, or kids don't care to hear them.
Yeah, we all tied up on these phones and whatnot, and what the text and stuff, but this stuff, you know, you just live it, and it's kind of unique, and I've told a few stories to the people, and they're always, man, that's a little out of the ordinary, which a lot of it was.
Yeah.
But AJ would go off. He...
If he got mad, it was bad, wasn't it?
It was bad. He would talk reasonably, and I know a lot of people who would say, AJ, we were in agreement with this, a little argument here and there, and then when AJ went, he would go. But to show you how he didn't have any regard for the consequences, he physically assaulted the district attorney in Liberty County in his own office in working hours, right in the middle of the day for the whole world to see. And when you have enough nerve to physically beat down the DA,
and not get any more than
he's in a different category than I am, I'll tell you that.
Anyway, so much stuff, Johnny, and that's obviously, I don't want you to get the idea that all foresters undergo stuff like this, but Johnny was
in his... No, they don't, thank goodness.
I bet. You know, in fact, I saw with the Texas Forestry Association, weren't you asked to speak one time somewhere or other places?
Well, not over the AJI.
I know, but just over
I forestry. Was on the Texas Forestry Service board, and I spoke a few times. Tried to help that organization out a little.
We've got Johnny and I have so much experiences. The only UFO I ever saw was with Johnny, and we got a story about that. We've got a story about how when we went to college, we joined an intramural. We created an intramural sports. I was going to tell a joke, ladies and gentlemen, but do we have time for the final joke? Are we out of here 10 minutes? What? Oh, okay. Yes, we are, ladies and gentlemen. Next week, we are going to have a gentleman who is involved in outwoods, backwoods camping and all to help fathers and sons and all get together. We'll have it. I'll tell you more about that gentleman later. Right now, we have got to leave, ladies and gentlemen. Hanging with the Hayters, this is Mark K. Johnny Sutton, thank you so much for being with us today. We'll get back next week, folks.
Hello, I'm Sonny Horn with Leaders Financial Group. For 25 years, Leaders has developed a working relationship with each of our clients that aid us in providing them opportunities to retire sooner than they likely thought possible. Our success is attributed largely to our thoroughness in drawing up a workable financial plan for each client. Saving money is tough for most, so we all need to receive the best long-term results possible for our efforts. Leaders Financial Group has earned a reputation for providing greater peace of mind for those who too often feel they're hoping against hope in what seems to be a most complicated financial market. Our goal at Leaders is to provide a keen sense of hope and financial security for those who come to us seeking direction. Process is simple. Phone call even more so. I'm Sonny Horn. Give me a call at 832-381-2515 and we'll help you establish a financial future that'll be ready when you're ready to retire.
And I'm Mark Hayter, one of the clients at Sonny Horn has helped retire sooner than I thought possible. It's our trust in him that led Kay and I to choose Leaders Financial Group as our sponsor.
Thanks for checking out this recording from Lone Star Community Radio. Lone Star Community Radio is Montgomery County's community radio station and broadcasted live from Conroe, Texas on IRLoneStar.com and Conroe's FM 104.5, 106.1. Interested in sponsoring this show, being a guest, hosting your own show, and please visit us online at irlonestar.com and check out the Contact Us page. We want to say thank you to our studio supporters, our traffic sponsor, Conroe Americana Music Festival at conroeamericanamusicfestival.com. For more information about the show, please check out the information below in the description.